Hi there, I'm Tom Pham. I'm an abdominal transplant surgeon, faculty here at Stanford, surgical director for living donor kidney transplant, and also surgical director for pediatric kidney transplant, and also the surgery clerkship director as well. Today, we're gonna be talking about the abdominal exam, all right, and specifically the surgical abdominal exam. And one thing to note about the abdominal exam is that it is just one portion of the history and physical. And to do a good focused abdominal exam, you have to have a good history and physical. This history that might pertain to the abdominal exam is quality of the pain that they're having, location of the pain, duration, other symptoms, prior history such as surgeries. All this will help you do a very good focused abdominal exam. So what are the goals of the surgical abdominal exam? As a surgeon, when you come in to assess the patient, you have these three things in your mind. One, does this patient need surgery? Two, does this patient need imaging? Three, if this patient doesn't need one or two, are they okay for just observation or pretty much non-surgery? Imaging, I want to point out, is extremely important because the abdominal exam helps you focus what type of imaging you need. An example is, if someone comes in with right upper quadrant pain, we know that the best type of imaging to assess it is an ultrasound. Whereas if someone comes in with right lower quadrant pain, the best type of imaging to assess it is a CT scan, all right? And so that's why the abdominal exam is extremely important and a component of that history and physical. So going straight into the actual abdominal exam itself, we have it broken down into certain categories here. One being preparation, positioning. Two being inspection. Three being auscultation, percussion. And four being palpation. And number five, I'll talk about specific maneuvers. When it comes to preparation position, which is the first step, preparation means preparing the patient. And so here we have Stephen. Thank you. And so I prepare Stephen by telling him I'm going to perform an abdominal exam, and I acknowledge that they're having pain. I know you're having a lot of pain, but I would like to examine to really assess the quality of your pain and where it is, okay? This may hurt, but let me know if it's too much pain for you, okay? I'm going to start off by positioning you flat. The reason I position the patient flat is because typically patients who present in the emergency room or in the ward with abdominal pain are typically sitting up in a bed. By stretching the abdomen flat and stretching those abdominal muscles may cause pain if they have severe peritonitis. So this is me performing the abdominal exam before I even do the actual palpation itself. And so I do position them flat, okay? And assessing how they react to that, okay? Once I assess them flat, I ask them to lay their arms to the side, okay? And then I'll go ahead and expose their abdomen. I'm gonna just roll your shirt up to your rib cage, up to pretty much seeing the entire abdomen just below the T4 where the nipples are, okay? And you wanna be able to see all the quadrants of the abdomen. How you know you expose enough of the abdomen is that you can see the umbilicus and the skin around it, all right? And the umbilicus represents the center of the abdomen. So when it comes to right upper quadrant, first left upper quadrant, these are all areas surrounding the umbilicus, okay? And usually the lower portion of it is usually the pubic symphysis, which is the bony prominence about right here, okay? And the upper portion being the xiphoid right here, okay? All right, and so the very first step before I even palpate is inspection, okay? Based off our history and physical, we should know whether they have prior surgeries, we should know whether they feel like they're more distended, etc. And what you really wanna do with inspection is see if that history correlates with what you can visually see. And sometimes it doesn't correlate with what you see. I might see a scar here, and Stephen didn't tell me he had prior surgery, so I should investigate that before I palpate. Other things that you can see is whether they're visibly distended. Does it look like their abdomen is filled with fluid? Does it look like they have large veins that suggest that they have portal hypertension? Do they have a protruding hernia at the umbilicus that is red and angry and causing them a lot of pain, discomfort in the area? So all this should be done prior to palpation in the inspection phase. Based on your history and physical, you should know where they're having most of their pain at. An example here is if Stephen comes in complaining of right upper quadrant pain here in the right upper quadrant, that should be the last place I examine. And so typically, what I will do is examine them in the quadrant that is opposite where their chief complaint is. So if they're complaining of right upper quadrant, I will go down to the left lower quadrant. The reason why is because if their pain is so severe that it's causing peritonitis, which is inflammation of the peritoneal lining, which causes pain throughout the abdomen, then they may be having pain in opposite areas. Also, you don't want to go chase the area that's causing the most discomfort, because if I do that and I trigger 10 out of 10 pain in that area, then it's going to be very difficult to get a dependable exam in the other areas. So let's start with palpation. Based on my history, I know he's having right upper quadrant pain, so I'm going to go down the left lower quadrant. How to properly palpate should be you should use your hand or multiple fingers, never just one finger, all right?
You could either use one hand or two hands. For today's example, I'll use two hands. And what you do is you start with light palpation. Light palpation is really just palpation of the skin, all right, and just the subcutaneous tissue, just like this, okay, to see if this is causing them pain. And as I palpate, I look at Steven's face to see how he reacts to my abdominal exam. Maybe just a grazing of the skin. They have a lot of anxiety and they're wincing 10 out of 10 pain, even though I did not irritate the peritoneum. Maybe just light palpation, okay, that causes discomfort, okay? And so I will go in and I will push slowly, really assessing what their pain is. And if they're comfortable, all right, not complaining of pain, then I'll push a little bit deeper down deep palpation, where I know I'm pushing the viscus around, where I know I'm pushing the peritoneum and irritating it, okay, in that area. And I'll move from quadrant to quadrant with the right upper quadrant being the sheaf complaint quadrant as the last quadrant. So I'll move here, light palpation to deep, looking at the patient's face, okay, and then going over here and really assessing it. Once I trigger an area that has pain and they say that hurts a lot, and then I will push again in the area just right next to really localize where this pain is and really to figure out, is the pain really pinpoint to this one area or is it really the patient's entire right flank as I push around there? So an example is I'll push here. Steven says he's having a lot of pain there. Okay, then I'll push a little bit here. Ask, is it less severe when I go there? Maybe they'll say yes, maybe they'll say no. But to really pinpoint the area where they're having their pain, okay? And that's what I do with palpation. So to go over some of the findings that you can have with palpation includes guarding and rebound tenderness, okay? Rebound tenderness is a sign of early peritonitis where the peritoneum is inflamed, but really is it where they have pain when you let go of the palpation. So this is when I push on the abdomen and I let go suddenly, they have some pain with that rebound, okay? That could be a sign of early peritonitis. Guarding is when the abdomen is rigid, meaning they are fighting and pushing against you, and I can't palpate the peritoneum because they're in so much pain, they're not able to relax the abdomen. That is what guarding is. And that is a sign of severe peritonitis, where their abdomen is rigid like a board. I can't push against them because they can't relax due to the pain that they're having. So that's rebound tenderness and guarding, which can be signs of peritonitis, okay? And so after palpation is done, there are specific maneuvers that you can look for when you're doing your palpation, all right? This includes Murphy's sign, this includes McBurney's point. Murphy's sign is a common sign of right upper quadrant pain. And what it is, it's pinpoint pain in the right upper quadrant and that causes such severe pain that it keeps the patient from breathing. So the cessation of inspiration, all right? And this is a classic finding of cholecystitis or some sort of gallbladder inflammation right there where they're not able to breathe because of how much pain they're having here that irritates the liver and the diaphragm. McBurney's point is a point, if you were to draw an imaginary line between the umbilicus and the anterior superiliac spine and go one-third from the acis, is typically where in the appendix is. And having pinpoint tenderness in this one area, all right, is a strong sign of appendicitis. That's what McBurney's point is. There are other maneuvers as well, such as Psoas Sign, all right, obturator sign, all right. And Psoas Sign, to give you an example here, is when you have pain in the right lower quadrant with flexion of the right thigh. And so why don't you go ahead and flex your right leg? And by giving resistance there, it causes pain here. And that's a sign of, again, appendicitis that is more retrocecal, irritating the psoas muscle. The abdominal exam is just one part of the entire history and physical, all right? And to do a good focused abdominal exam, you have to have a good history, all right? And as a surgeon, when you perform that abdominal exam, you're thinking of these three things: surgery, imaging, or none of the above, which would be observation, okay? And having an algorithm for how you perform the abdominal exam and realizing that your exam starts before you even palpate the abdomen is key. So thank you.